receive the word. I believe the word. I work on the word. The word works on me. Now, I made us understand on Monday that this world in which we live in exists in two parts. We've got the spiritual realm, or the spirit's realm, and the physical realm, which I said that the spiritual realm is where destinies are created. That is where the things that God has said concerning us are. The physical realm is what that God has said concerning us in the spirit manifests here in the physical. I made us understand that when a prophetic word comes, the prophet or the prophetic word talks about that which is in the spirit and releases it to us here in the physical. You need to understand that when a man, a prophet, looks at you and tells you that within the next year you are going to prosper, you are going to be this, God is saying you are going to be this, if you look and he listen to the word, most of the time the word goes or might not be the same as what you are feeling in the present, but the prophecy gets into the spirit and downloads that which is on the mind of God. It tells you in the physical. Now, after you have received a prophetic word, it is the onus lies on you as a child of God to do what is necessary for that prophetic word to manifest. The prophetic word is that which is in the spirit. But now, what do I do to make sure that the prophetic word that I have received come into manifestation? There are most of us here that possibly you might have received the word and you don't know what is happening. And it's like the word, you received it even about 10 years ago, 5 years ago, but it looks like the word is not coming. Let me tell you this. After the prophet gives you the word, it is not the responsibility of the prophet or the man of God that gave you the word to make sure the word happens. It is your responsibility. Say, it's my responsibility. I am just like a messenger. When I was praying in my hotel room today, I prayed and trust God and said, God, what do I go and tell your people? I don't preach that which is convenient. I preach as I am commanded and instructed by God. Are you hearing me? This is what happens. Like, let's assume this book is for me. My guy, come. I like to demonstrate the Lord. Let's assume this book is from, I am God, and this man is the prophet. Your name, Dennis. Dennis is the prophet, and then Pastor Mike is the church. Now watch this. I am God. This is my book. Dennis says, God, what do I go and give? What is the message that you have for Pastor Mike? I give it to Dennis. Go give it to Pastor Mike. So now the prophet or the carrier of the message is just like a messenger. Are you hearing me? Every man of God, anytime they stand on the pulpit, it is that which they have received from God that they are giving to the church. So, a man of God, let me drop this thing here to help you. A man of God is just a representation of God in the church. If God wants to give a word to his people, he gives it through the servant of God and the servant of God relays it to the people. So you need to understand that you need to cherish and appreciate your servant or your pastor or your bishop or whoever has over your soul. Most of us, we salute and respect our doctors so much. We salute and love and respect our lawyers so much, but we don't respect the one that takes care of your souls. You know, you even know the date of birth of your doctor or your lawyer or that manager at work. And when it is his birthday, you buy him a gift, but you don't even know the date of birth of your pastor or your bishop. How many of you here know the date of birth of bishop? See, only about 1%. Say mercy. Now, when the prophet gives the prophetic word, the responsibility lies on you to make sure you pray the word into manifestation. Number one, that which will make your prophecy be released or manifest for you is that, number one, receive the word in faith. Say, receive it in faith. I said today I'm taking it slow. Amen. Number one, when you receive a word or the word of God comes to you, receive that word in faith. It does not matter how it looks or how contrary it might go to what you are feeling in the now. Receive that word in faith. If you receive the word in faith, the word has 90% chance of happening. If you don't receive any word in faith, trust you me, it might not happen. Are you hearing me? When a word comes to you, when Mary received the word from angel Gabriel, Mary said, "Be it unto me according to the word." Hebrews 11:6 said that they that comes to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. When you come to God, or you God gives you a word, you must believe that word. Believe that it is possible. Believe, you know, let me tell you this. Any word that I have declared in the air, if you received it in faith, it shall be so in your life. Are you hearing me? Number two, when you receive a prophetic word, pray the word into manifestation. Now, the word is in the spirit, but you've got to push it from the realm of the spirit for it to manifest in the realm of the physical. The word is in the spirit. You've got to push and pray for that, for the manifestation of that word. Other than that, you will wait and wait, and that word might not happen. Now, give me Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. My guy, sit down for a minute. Other than that, you might stand for long. Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. Okay. They say, "Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. So shall the Lord make bright clouds and give unto them showers of rain to everyone grass in the field." Now, this scripture, if you went to a very good school, you know that there is a problem with that scripture, that sentence there. That is if you went to a good school. "Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain." If you've done analytical reading before, you know there is something wrong here. It says, "Ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so shall the Lord make bright clouds and give unto them showers of rain to everyone grass of the field." Number one, if it is time for rain, do you ask for rain? No. If it is rainy season, automatically we know that the rains will fall. If it is dry season, now that it is summer in Kenya, we know that the sun is hitting us so hard. When it is summer, you don't ask for the sun to shine, right? When it is raining, you don't ask for the rains, right? They just come. But from this scripture, God is saying, the prophet is saying, ask the Lord for rain in the time of the rain. Are you following me? Why should I ask God for rain in the time of the rain? Pastor Charles, good to see you. Now, how do you ask God for something like ask God for sun in the time of summer? It doesn't make sense. What the prophet is trying to say is simple. It can be the time for your miracle, but if you don't ask God for it, you might not have it. It can be the time for you to prosper, but if you don't ask God for your prosperity, you might still be broke. It can be the time for you to get married, but if you don't ask God for that marriage, it might not come. Let me tell you this. Paul said God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places, but why are we still struggling? Why? The reason is simple. Most of us, we don't take the time to pull the blessings and our prophetic destiny from the spirit realm into the manifestation of the physical. Every one of us, you can be whatever God created you to be. God told Jeremiah, "Before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you and have ordained you a prophet." At the age of 5, Jeremiah was a prophet, but he didn't know. At the age of 6, he was a prophet, but he still didn't know. At the age of 9, that means that even at the age of 5, his prophetic ministry and his greatness was already determined in the spirit.
But now, Jeremiah could have missed it and not ended up as a prophet if he sat down and not being spiritual enough. That is what happens. Most of the time, God has blessed us with a lot of blessings, but if you are not very careful, you might miss the blessing if you don't push it from the spirit realm into the physical. Are you following me? See, prophetic timing. Every prophetic word that you receive, whether God himself said it, or any man of God said it, or God said it to you in your closet of prayer, you need to push it through prayer. God calls Moses and Abraham and said to Abraham, your children shall be in captivity for 400 years. He said, Abraham, of a surety, your seed shall be in captivity for 400 years. God said, of a surety. Give me Genesis chapter 15. Let me show you something. Genesis chapter 15. Genesis the 15th chapter, verse 13. Genesis the 15th chapter, verse 13. And God, and he said to Abraham, that is God speaking, know of a surety. Now, when God said know of a surety, that means that of a certainty. I am certain of what I'm talking about. And this is God speaking here. God the Father, this is not prophet or pastor or bishop or anybody. This is God speaking here, right? Are we here? I want you to follow me, yeah? Get the message. He said, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and they shall serve them for and afflict them for how many years? 400 years. How many years? How many years? How many years? God said they shall be there for 400 years. And God did not mince words. He said, know of a surety. I am certain about what I'm saying. And then continue reading for me. Let me just drop this and then we continue. And also also that nation whom they shall serve, I will judge afterwards, and they shall come out with a great substance. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Say they shall come out with a great substance. That means that if God allows you to go through any predicament, you will not come out like that. You will not come out empty-handed. You shall come out with a great substance. That tells me that, number one, if God allows me to go through a predicament, I will come out with a great substance. Number two, if God allows me to go through any predicament, there is a time bound to that predicament. He said for 400 years. I don't know how long your predicament has stayed, but I came with a simple word to let you understand before I go on that problem, that predicament has an expiry date. Did you come to church? I said, that problem, that predicament is got an expiry date. Everything that has a beginning has an end. If it ever began, then it will end. I know it started on a certain date. I prophetically decree over your life, that pain it shall end. That frustration shall end. That setback it shall end. Every negative situation you are going through, I declare an end to it in the name of Jesus. Now, let me just continue my message. Now, the Bible says, God said to Abraham, they shall be in captivity for 400 years. Now, let's go to Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. Let me show you something. Exodus chapter 12. God said 400 years. God said 400 years. Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. Now, and this Exodus chapter 12, verse 40, 40, verse 40. Now, the scripture says, let me read. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in captivity. Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was how many? Was how many? So what was happening? So God said 400. This one, it was not Prophet David that said 400. God, the Father, himself. He said they shall be in captivity for 400 years. But the scripture tells us they were in captivity for 430 years. So where from the extra 30 years? Can I tell you why it happened? The reason why they ended up being in captivity for 430 years was this. When the 400 years was up, they were still sitting down, not crying unto God, not calling God for their deliverance. When the 400 years was up, nobody called on God. They thought that because God said it, it would automatically happen. Hey, it doesn't happen like that. So when God met Moses, he told Moses, I have heard the cry of my people. It was when they began to cry unto God that God sent Moses for their deliverance. Let me tell you this. It doesn't matter who you are. If you don't call on God for your deliverance, for your breakthrough, you remain there thinking, oh, the prophecy will come to pass, and you'll be blaming wrong people for your predicament. Instead of you to pray and call on God. God himself gave the prophetic word here, but he, at the end of the day, because they did not pray for their deliverance, they ended up being in captivity for extra 400 years. If your captivity, the end of your predicament is up, and possibly you didn't know how to come out after tonight, go to your room, your house, and tell that devil, it is over. I have been in this situation for far too long. I have heard the word of the Lord that told me today, I've got to come out of my captivity. I've got to come out of this situation. And the devil has had a free day in my life for far too long. It is time for me to come out. When you receive a word, pray through the word. Pray through the word. And number three, when you receive a word, sow into the word. You don't receive a word with faith. You receive a word with faith. You receive a word with prayer. You receive a word and you connect to the word. When Abraham received the prophetic word, he sowed into the word. When Isaac received the prophetic word, he sowed into the word. Let me tell you this. Anytime the people of old, they received a prophetic word, they erected an altar at the place and poured oil, made a sacrifice and said, I connect with the word. Let me tell you this. That is why some people don't understand how I operate at times. Why is it that after every prayer section, I lead you to release a seed? This is the revelation. If I make you pray and I make you to receive, there is the third thing as a prophet that I know that will help you. If I don't let you do it, I am not helping you. The little you can, just take it and connect with every word you receive. Are you hearing me? Don't just receive a word with your mouth and sit down. Anytime you are even in your house and you are in a moment of prayer and you pray seriously about anything, take a seat, speak over it. When you come to church, put it on the altar. No one may not understand what you are doing, but you know the revelation you had when we had the anniversary and the revelation you had when you were in the closet of prayer. Don't just be praying with your mouth. I told you on Sunday that your sacrifice speaks better than your mouth can speak. Can I tell you something? There are times that on your sick bed you can't even pray. There are times that you'll be so incapacitated that you can't even do nothing. That time, it is that which you have placed on the altar that's what will speak for you. Now, let me start my sermon. Genesis chapter 32. I was building the platform. Genesis chapter 32. Say prophetic timing. Genesis chapter 32. Verse 24. And Jacob was left alone. Say alone. Say alone. Say alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. We can stay here for the whole service, and then we can close. And Jacob, number one, was left alone. Number two, and there wrestled a man, a theophany, a God man, with him until the breaking of the day. Number first thing you need to know, Jacob was left alone. Number two, the second thing you need to understand, that a God man, an angel, came to wrestle with him. Number three, he did not wrestle with him till the end. He wrestled with him for a certain specific time until the breaking of the day. Let's continue reading. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. And he said unto him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel, for as a prince thou hast power with God and with men, and has prevailed. Amen. Now, this scripture that we read talks about a man by the name of Jacob. We all know from the verse 27 of Genesis that Jacob took the blessing of his brother Esau, and after he had taken the blessing of his brother Esau, he was blessed. Thank you, Holy Spirit. he was blessed by his father, and after he had received the blessing, he left the house. And Esau was the one that was home. But when the guy came, he was angry. And his mother, he was angry because, not because of anything, but because his brother has received the blessing. And I asked myself, what blessing did his brother receive? They were just mere words that the father spoke on the guy. But the guy was so cross, he was so vexed, and he could not even settle. When his father died, it was Esau that stayed home with all the possessions of the father. But, can I tell you something? I wrote in the book that blessing is not in physical things. Blessing is in what is within. Words spoken over your life in this convention can give you what 1,000,000 shillings cannot give you. Jacob left with words, and that words had the ability to bring every other thing that he needed. Esau stayed at home, but he had nothing. Can I tell you something? After this convention, the words spoken into the air, they shall make you that which ordinary people doesn't have. Now, because he left home and stole the blessing from his brother, he went into exile and stayed there. And God told him, after some time, go back to your kindred, to your father's house, because I want to do something new. So the guy get his family, Laban, and his family from his uncle Laban, and all his servants, and everything that he had, and they started making the journey. Now watch this. When they were making the journey and they were coming home, they got to a point that now Jacob started getting scared that what is going to happen? If this guy sees me, he might kill me. His brother, talking about his brother. He says, every one of you go ahead of me. He sent his wives, his children, and he sent presents in 2 bands. Jacob left home with the staff, but he came back with presents with 2 bands because he carried a word. Say a word. Say a word. Not to go there. Let me continue. Now, after everybody had left him, and the Bible says, and Jacob was left alone. And there came a man, an angel, to come and rest here with him. Now watch this. Why? The first question I asked myself when I got there, when I was meditating on it many years ago, was that why didn't the angel come when the guy had people around him? At times, God will leave you at a place where you are alone until he comes to visit you. At times, there are certain people in your life, they've got to leave you until the visitation of God can come. There are certain people in your life, if they don't leave you, God can't bless you. There are certain negative people in your life, if you don't disassociate yourself from them, God can't bless you. There are certain people in your life, if they don't leave you, you can't prosper. There are certain people in your life, if they don't leave you, you can't get married. There are certain people in your life, if they don't leave you, your life can't go on. But today, whether they like it or they don't like it, after this convention, I prophesy over your life, any negative person in your life that is limiting God's favor, limiting God's blessings, in the name of Jesus, I disconnect them from your life. I disconnect them from your life. I disconnect them from your life, in the name of Jesus. The other day, Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 6, in the year that King Hosea died, I, Isaiah, I saw the Lord. As long as Hosea was on the throne, Isaiah could not see the glory of God and the countenance of Jehovah. There are certain people, they've got to live your life. God has to annihilate them before you can see the glory. You know what? You need to understand this. Association determines how far you can go. The connection and the people that are connected to you will determine how far you can go in life. If you don't know, that is it. The very fact that Joseph entered the house of Potiphar, everything started working well. Likewise, there are certain people, immediately they come close to you, everything starts going downhill. But I prophesy after tonight, if there is any negative person in your life, I decree and declare by the power of Jehovah, I delete them from your life. I delete them from your ministry. I delete them from that family. If you are here, shall I receive that? Any person that is limiting God's glory in your life, you know, as long as Lot was with Abraham, God never spoke to Abraham. Immediately Lot and Abraham part ways, God comes and says, Abraham, see, and as far as your eyes can see, I will give you. There are certain people, they are like Lot. With their presence, God never speaks. But after tonight, they are leaving you. 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 Somebody shall fire. They shall live by fire. You know, if everybody is your friend, you have a problem. Everybody is your friend. Hey, there are some people, they should be acquaintances. You meet them. Hello, sir. How are you? And that's it. Fine. Are you hearing me? There are some people, they say, hello, how are you? Fine. God bless you. See you on Sunday. Everybody should not be your friend. If you've got so many friends, you've got so many problems. You understand? You need to siphon and be able to distinguish who is your friend and who is not. Some people, we want to be in the good books of everybody. Who told you? Even Jesus, people talk bad about him. Even Jesus, who are you? Because so you want to befriend everybody. Today, if you are like that, I deliver you. Can I tell you something? Let me just drop this in. Eh? Jesus, he had the 70. He had the 12. Even among the 12 that he called his disciples, he had the 3. When it was going to the top of the mountain, he didn't go with everybody. He went with only 3. And when it came to who would sleep on his lap, it was only 1. What are you talking about? You need to bring a demarcation between who comes close to you. You save money. You save yourself from problems. Can I tell you another thing? Some of you, you are like the people that cast news. Once you meet everybody, you talk. Because you've got so many friends and people will be selling your story. Everybody knows your story. What is wrong with you? Everybody knows your story. Can I tell you something? Your secret is your power. Your secret is your power. That which makes Samson is that when he had a secret, immediately he told his secret to the woman. The Bible says, and Samson became like any ordinary man. What are you talking about? Correct. What are you talking about? I'll come again. Now the Bible says, let's continue preaching so that. And the Bible says, and Jacob was left alone. And the Bible says, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. Say, wrestled. How many of you know wrestling? You've seen a wrestling match before. Tomorrow I'll talk about wrestling match. Tomorrow's sermon, you can't afford to miss it. It will be power. Say, fire. Now, they wrestled a man with Jacob until the breaking of the day. And anytime you see the word wrestle or fight in the Old Testament, it is an epitome of prayer in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, for God's children to possess anything, they had to fight. They had to fight with bows, arrows, cutlasses, and knives. They had to engage themselves in physical battles. But in the New Testament, in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1, the Bible says the Old Testament is a shadow of the New. Now, in the New Testament, we don't fight with knives and cutlasses in order to possess. We fight the Spirit. We fight through prayer. For you to be able to possess your possessions in the New Testament, you battle in the Spirit in order to get. So, as Jacob was wrestling with the angel, literally in contemporary terms, we would say Jacob was praying for a word from the angel. Are you hearing me? Jacob was praying for a word from the angel, saying, angel, you've got to change my life. Angel, you've got to bless me. Angel, you've got to give me a word. Now I ask Jacob, you just received a word from your father a few years ago. So what word are you receiving again? There are some people, they are like that. Every word, every time they meet prophet, they want a word. Hey, why? You force the prophet to give you a prophetic word. Say mercy. Jacob just received the word from his father that you are going to be great. Your brothers are going to bow down to you. And he meets an angel. He's asking for a word. So I asked myself, what was Jacob asking for? Now, God made me understand. The Spirit of God made me understand that even though Jacob had received the word, he was not living the manifestation of the word. The word was still in the spirit. It had not manifested in the physical. So Jacob was literally praying and pushing for the physical manifestation of that prophecy. Are you hearing me? He was pushing and asking God for the rain, even though he knew it was the time for the rain. Jacob began to push, and the angel said, what is your name? Say, what is your name? Say, what is your name? Jacob pushed and pushed until the angel had to break Jacob's thigh. You know, in this time and age, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 12, from the days of John the Baptist until now, in other words, until today, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence and the violent taken it by force. There are three levels of violence there. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, number one, and two, it takes the spiritually active violence to take it by force. So the angel now had to bless Jacob anyway, and that is the kind of attitude I want you and I to have when you come into the house of God. You tell God, God, if you don't bless me, I am not living here. Jacob said, angel, if you don't change my life, I am not living today. And the angel had to give Jacob a word. He said, what is your name? Say, what is your name? Say, what is your name? And he said, my name is Jacob. The name Jacob means a supplanter, a cheat, a deceiver. So that was the original meaning of the name. It's like somebody walking here and we call him generous or kind. That means that is, as he goes, everybody knows this one is generous. So as Jacob walked on the street, everybody knows this one is a deceiver, a deceiver, a cheat, a deceiver, a cheat. Now watch this. He deceived his brother. He went to his uncle's house and he started outsmarting the uncle. Honestly, his name was having effect on his life. He was called a deceiver from his mother's womb. He deceived his brother. He went to his uncle's house and someone older than him, he started outsmarting the uncle. Now, the angel said, what is your name? And he said, my name is Jacob. And he said, from today, you shall no longer be called Jacob but Israel. And that was the name human beings had given him. So Jacob was asking for a blessing from the angel, and the angel was asking for Jacob's name. When the angel checked the name Jacob in the realm of the spirit, there was no name registered in the spirit. There was no blessing registered in the spirit with the name Jacob. So the angel checked and said, young man, you are walking on earth with the wrong identity. People are misinterpreting who you are. Everybody thinks you are unmarried. Everybody thinks you are broke. Everybody thinks you are a cheat. Everybody thinks you are stealing people's husbands. That is a wrong identity. In the realm of the spirit, you are called Israel. You are a nation. You are so blessed. And there are certain people here, under the sound of my voice, you are like Jacob. You walk on earth with a wrong identity. People call you the woman that is 40 years and still not married, the man that is 45 and still broke. You are walking on earth with an identity and the ideology of men. But after tonight, I prophesy over your life that negative identity is over. I pray for the original identity from Jehovah to be released over your life. Anything that God has in store in the realm of the spirit, I pray in the name of Jesus, may it be released over your life. There is a blessing in the spirit with your name on it. There is a blessing in the spirit with Matthew on it. There is a
blessing in the spirit with David on it. There is a blessing in the spirit with Susan on it. There is a blessing in the spirit with Joseph on it. There is a blessing in the spirit with Michael on it. And I pray in the name of Jesus, and the blessing in the realm of the spirit that's got your identity on by the power of the Holy Ghost, may it drop on your life. May it drop on your life. You shall not be exempted tonight. You shall not live empty-handed. As people are getting marriages, you shall also get your marriage. As people are getting prosper, you shall also prosper. As people are getting financial breakthroughs, you shall also have a financial breakthrough. That wrong identity is over. That negative name, it is over. I pray for you in Jesus' name. May that original identity be released. May that which God has said be released. I pray for people here. No more setback. No more negative identity. No more wrong names from people. People have been talking about you everywhere, and they are calling you names you are not. But after today, may God release and reveal the true you to the world. I said, may God reveal the true you to the world. You are not who they said you are. You might have done what they said you did, but you are not who they said you are. You are better than that. There is a better and a bigger blessing that God has in store. I pray for you. From today, a new you is coming out. A new David is coming out. A new Susan is coming out. A new Mary is coming out. Put your name there and say, a new me. Say, a new me. A new David is coming out. The other day, the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 1, Hannah was crying every now and then because she had no child. But in chapter 2, the Bible begins by saying, and Hannah rejoiced in the Lord. Why? Because God opened a new chapter in the life of Hannah. The chapter you were in was the chapter of tears, the chapter of sorrow, the chapter of setback, the chapter of pain. But after this convention, I prophesy, a new chapter is opening for you. 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 If I hear, shout, I receive it. Somebody shout, a new beginning.
Be on your feet. Another time.